HDL, the quote-unquote good cholesterol. Where does HDL stand in predicting overall risk, right? So we mentioned that high LDL-C, high ApoB, more or less causal in cardiovascular disease risk. But for those who have a high LDL-C, they might mention that, well, my good cholesterol, my HDL-C is also extremely high, so that must mitigate risk to some degree, right? How would you respond to someone who puts that forth?
I would follow the same logic we've already followed like two or three times in this conversation. You basically have to look at the evidence, the totality of the evidence, right? You look at the observational evidence. You don't dismiss that. It has value, but then you also look at everything else that we know, all the causal tests. And then you put everything together and you see what the total landscape is likely to be. So similar to the particle size, it's understandable that people rely on or believe that HDL cholesterol might be protective because the associations are there. Very clearly, all the way back to Framingham, you see an inverse correlation, very strong. You see people who have lower HDL cholesterol levels tend to have higher risk. And it's a powerful correlation. You see it consistently in epidemiology. The problem is, and that created a lot of excitement. People in the field were very excited about it. HDL cholesterol, that's where good cholesterol, bad cholesterol came from. Fortunes were invested in coming up with drugs that raised HDL cholesterol that hopefully would be protective. Dozens of randomized controlled trials were run, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars per trial. We're talking a massive, colossal endeavors trying to test this and no doubt rooting for it to work. The problem is causal tests have consistently been a dud. So the clinical trials, the randomized control trials, there's been at least 39 that I know of. There's a meta-analysis that looks at 39 randomized control trials, several different drugs, at least three classes of drugs, three different drugs that do effectively raise HDL cholesterol, but you don't see an improvement of risk. The risk doesn't come down. And then the genetics, same thing. When you look at HDL in isolation, you do see a correlation with an inverse correlation with risk, which would appear to be protective. But then when you bring in ApoB and these other metrics, that effect goes away. So it's completely abrogated. So when you put everything together, what it's very consistently telling us is that it's a marker. It can be predictive in a population setting. That's why this is confusing and it's hard to explain, right? Because it's not, you know, you can point to the studies and say, look, you have a better correlation of HDL cholesterol in this population study than even LDL cholesterol. So how can you say that this isn't protective and isn't causal? And it is, it's not intuitive, right? It's tough for us to see this, but you can have correlations with things that are really strong, but then do not have a causal link. I mean, one analogy would be if we're trying to figure out what causes lung cancer, and let's say we don't know yet, and maybe we suspect that it has something to do with smoking, but we're not quite sure. And so we go into people's houses, we do an inventory of their lives, and then we follow them and we see who gets lung cancer. We find out that there's a strong correlation between people who own ashtrays and people who get lung cancer 20 years later. So now I say, well, or you tell me, man, you're smoking a lot. Aren't you worried? And I say, no, but I gave away all my ashtrays, so I'm protected. I'm no longer at high risk. It seems silly in this setting, but what I'm doing is I'm taking a correlation that is really strong and I'm extrapolating causality, right? If the causal links are not clear in our heads, it's not hard to make that mistake. And that is what's being done in general with HDL cholesterol when we assume that it's causal and having it high is going to be protective. Now, I think it's reasonable to say as well that although the evidence is very consistent in pointing against the causality there, first of all, we were talking about major atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. I'm not ruling out that HDL cholesterol could have a protective effect or a positive effect in immune function. Maybe in other peripheral artery disease, there's some indication that might be the case, but not with these events, not with heart disease, not with myocardial infarction, with the ischemic strokes, these major things that we're worried about. And so to posit that having high LDL cholesterol, or even worse, high ApoB, that would be somehow mitigated by having high HDL cholesterol, is just incredibly difficult to justify that based on the totality of evidence. The other thing to say is that we are talking about HDL cholesterol. We're not ruling out that the particle itself, HDL, might have a protective effect. It hasn't been studied as much. There have been some experiments. There are some mimetics that people have used where it's kind of an artificial lipoprotein that's made synthetically, and then it's injected into people. And they showed that it does sort of replicate the reverse cholesterol transport function of HDL. But then when you inject it into people, it doesn't lower risk. So, you know, the function of HDL having some protective effect hasn't been ruled out. But the simple idea that just raising HDL cholesterol is going to protect me and make up for high LDL cholesterol or high ApoB, I would highly discourage people from thinking that way. I wouldn't encourage anyone I cared about to go along those lines. It's just really dangerous. And I also see incredible agreement on this when I interact with on Twitter with these leading experts. You know, and they're actually more categorical than I am when they talk about this. Tom Dayspring or Sam Tsimikas, they are so clear on this. They say we don't even look at HDL cholesterol anymore. And they, by the way, they extend this logic to the ratios. This idea, almost not a day goes by that somebody doesn't ask me if triglycerides over HDL cholesterol is not a better metric than LDL cholesterol. What you do when you take a metric that isn't reliable, that isn't reflective of, that isn't causal, and you throw it in a ratio, is you end up with an unreliable ratio. And it's not hard to see that if my HDL cholesterol shoots up through whatever lifestyle change, but nothing else changes, that ratio is going to look better, but I've done nothing causally to protect myself. So yeah, I see these people being incredibly categorical and clear about the fact that they don't even pay attention to HDL cholesterol anymore. Again, I would say follow ApoB. Say.